हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ नोमन पटेल एंड टुडे वी विल बी लुकिंग इनटू द फिफ्थ पार्ट ऑफ आवर सीरीज ऑफ लेक्चर्स व्हिच इज़ ऑन बायोकेमिस्ट्री स्पॉटर। इफ़ यू आर व्यूइंग दिस वीडियो डायरेक्टली, आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग व्हिच इज़ पार्ट 1, 2 एंड सो ऑन, सो दैट यू विल बी इन द सिंक्रनी ऑफ द वीडियोज एंड डोंट मिस एनी ऑफ द स्पॉट, एज ईच एंड एवरी स्पॉट इज़ इम्पॉर्टेंट एंड हु नोज दैट विच स्पॉट इज़ गोइंग टू बी आज। So it is better that you view each and every spot. You can view the previous part of the spotters by clicking on the I button which is on the top of the screen. Also, I have put the link to my previous videos which I have uploaded in the description box. You can view from there. Also, if you haven't subscribed to the channel, do subscribe it as it will be useful to you because I am uploading such useful videos every now and then. Also, don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever our video are uploaded. So let's begin with the fifth part of the spotters. So continuing with the 35th spot, it says that we have to identify the test, we have to write the principle of the test and the use of the test. So in the given test tube, there is a classical violet color ring that we can see, and this is the identifying point of this test. So this test is the Mollist test, and what is the principle of the test? So the principle of the test is that all the carbohydrates, when treated with concentrated sulfuric acid, undergoes a dehydration reaction to give furfural compounds. These furfural compounds condense with the alpha naphthol and form a colored compounds. Now, what is the clinical significance? So the clinical significance is that this Mollist test is used for the identification of carbohydrates, as it is specific only for the carbohydrates. Moving to the next spot, in this we can see two test tube out of which the C is the control and T is the test. Test is that in which we have performed our desired reactions. So we have to identify the test, and also we have to state that how does this differs from the Benedict's test and give the significance, importance of this test. Let's look. So the given test is the Barford's test. The thing is that this test takes place in the acidic medium, and the Benedict's test takes place in the basic medium. And this test is used for the identification of the monosaccharides. So it means that which is the test that is for sure given by the monosaccharides, it is a Barford's test. Let's look into the next spot. In here we can see two vessels in which the A vessel has consist of the reagent and B vessel also consists the reagent. The reagent name you can easily see written on the bottle. So which of the following two displayed reagents are used for the inversion test for the sucrose, and what is the use of the other reagent? Let's look into it. So reagent B is the concentrated hydrochloric acid HCl, and reagent A is the concentrated sulfuric acid. The use of the reagent B is the inversion test, which is basically a confirmatory test for the sucrose, and the use of the reagent A, which is sulfuric acid, it is used in the Mollist test. Let's look into the next spot. Next spot basically is a clinical case solving question. Here we can see there are two equipments written and the case is given. So the given case is that there is a 34-year-old female who has been admitted to the emergency department with atrial fibrillation. Blood sample has been drawn from it for the estimation of the serum electrolytes. So which among the two, A and B, is used for the estimation of the serum electrolytes, and what is the use of the other instrument? So the given equipment B is used to measure the serum electrolyte levels, and the equipment A is the colorimeter, and the equipment B is the flame photometer. So flame photometer is mainly used for the measurement of the electrolytes, basically the serum electrolyte values. So what is the use of the other instrument, that is colorimeter? It is a device to test the concentration of the solution by measuring its absorbance of a specific wavelength of light. that is to be not confused by the tri-stimulus colorimeter that is used to measure the colors in general. Looking to the next spot, the patient of the diabetes mellitus are advised to supplement with the dietary fiber. This is the most common advice that a doctor gives to a patient who is suffering to diabetes mellitus. So now, how does this dietary fiber help this patient, and what is the nutritive value of this dietary fiber? Look to the answer. So the dietary fiber promotes the utilization of glucose. So this will ultimately decrease the blood glucose level and inhibits the absorption of dietary cholesterol. So as dietary cholesterol is not much absorbed, it does not affect the body regularly. Like it doesn't get stored. And once it gets stored, let's suppose once it gets stored, so it can lead to cardiac problems also. And thus, this following two mechanisms helps in the regulation of the blood glucose and the serum cholesterol levels, which are high in the diabetic patients. So now also this promotes the peristaltic movements, provides the rough phase, and thus relieves the problem of constipation and protects from the piles and the colon cancers. Now, rough phase has what nutritive value? It has no nutritive value since it is not digested. Let's look into the next spot. The given spot is also a case in which there is a fair chubby boy who has brought to hospital with a complaint that he has a mental retardation. Blood biochemistry revealed that phenylalanine level was abnormally high. Phenylpyruvate was present in the appreciable amount in the urine. So this last two lines is the catching point to answer this spot. So what is the question? What is a probable diagnosis? And what are the other metabolites that can be found in the urine? So the child is suffering from the phenylketonuria, that is a congenital disorder of the phenylalanine metabolism. So now here you can see that phenylalanine is abnormally high. So as phenylketonuria is occurring in the patient, which is a disorder of the phenylalanine metabolism, as phenylalanine is not metabolized properly, this leads to this condition. Now what is the cause of this? The cause is that due to the deficiency of the phenylalanine hydroxylase enzyme that is very important in conversion of phenylalanine to tyrosine. So due to this phenylalanine, due to the deficiency of this enzyme, phenylalanine gets accumulated in the body and its abnormal level gets elevated. And it's abnormally get elevated. What are the other metabolites excreted in the urine? These are phenylacetylglutamine and phenyllactate. Moving to the next spot, so the given is a graphical presentation, and we have to state the type, which type of inhibition is this, what is the effect in the KM and the VMAX value, and give the one example of this type of inhibition. So now the important catch point of this spot to answer is that here you have to always look on the KM and the VMAX value. So the KM and the VMAX value will always give that what type of inhibition it is. So as KM has no change and VMAX is decreased, so this is an example of a non-competitive inhibition. So example is of the enolase enzyme that catalyzes the conversion of the 2-phosphoglycerate to phosphoenol pyruvate, which is inhibited by the sodium fluoride. Alright, so this is basically the thing that is used in the collection of the blood samples. You have to remember this. Now, the last question. This is also a case solving question in which a 54-year-old woman was bedbound in a nursing home, began to develop swelling on her left leg. She was then evaluated with the venous Doppler USG and was found to have a deep vein thrombosis, DVT. She was immediately started on heparin to prevent the clot for further enlarging. So what is the chemical nature of heparin and what is the mechanism of action of heparin? See, this is the classical case in which the patient is bedridden. So whenever your patient is bedridden, it develops the thrombosis, deep vein thrombosis due to the not movement of the legs is there. So the circulation of blood is not much effective as it was earlier, so the thrombus starts develop. So now we use heparin, which is an anticoagulant in it, which helps in the removal of the thrombus and breaking it. So heparin is the sulfated mucopolysaccharide, and it is an anticoagulant that is widely used in the clinical practice. Now, what is the mechanism of action? How does this heparin act? Binding of heparin to the antithrombin molecule produces a conformational change, which promotes the binding of the latter to thrombin, that is heparin to thrombin, which is inhibited. And thus, fibrinogen is not converted to fibrin and the coagulation is inhibited. So this is the mechanism how heparin acts. So guys, hope you have enjoyed this part. Do tell us in the comment section that how useful this video is for your studies. And if you really like this video, just give a thumbs up. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Share our channel as much as possible with your friends, colleagues, friends of friends, and almost each and everyone you know. Once again, thanks for watching. So until then, we'll be meeting next time with the sixth part of this quarter. So till then, bye.